cancer became, I think, so much more lonely.
To then now face a potential cancer epidemic, which is following a COVID pandemic.
I don't think this is something we're going to know the true impact of until many years from now.
Welcome, everybody. It's time to talk about the C word again. And today we want to talk about the impact of COVID-19 on cancer and cancer care. So my question to all of you is, what does this really mean in real terms for patients, for their loved ones, for the health systems? Mary, you are one of these people or patients. So you were in active cancer treatment. And what was the direct impact for you just entering basically cancer treatment?
Yes. Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to participate because I did not see my oncologist in person from February 2020 until April 2021. It was all telehealth. My chemotherapy continued, but at a satellite center because they limited the census, you know, the number of people that would go into to clinic at different times. But I didn't see my doctor for a year. And he would try to evaluate if I had, swelling. You take your camera and you put it, you have to take off your sock and you show your doctor your ankle and you touch your ankle to see if you have edema. You show your abdomen and you press it. And he's trying to tell, you know, you could tell by your face if you're having pain. The practice of medicine just, you know, changed so quickly. And cancer became, I think, so much more lonely, and you were alone.
Mary, you make a really good point in relation to telemedicine. I think telemedicine has done a lot of good things, but it is not the panacea that people are making out. There are certain things, yes, you can do digitally, but there are other things, and you know, you've made really good examples there, that you know, it isn't really possible to do that.
Mark, you are on the other side of the Atlantic. You are in Belfast. Could you give us a little bit the European perspective? What for you were the real terms and your experience?
Thank you very much, Susanna. So what we did was we looked at two very straightforward observations. One was in hospital trusts throughout the United Kingdom. What was the impact on the diagnostic pathway? And what we found was that 7 out of every 10 people at that time, March, April 2020, were not getting referred to cancer services either because they weren't going to the services because they were afraid they might catch COVID. They were also afraid maybe that they were actually troubling the doctor for no reason. And then similarly, we decided we wanted to look at the treatment pathway. And what we found was that 4 out of 10 cancer patients were not receiving their chemotherapy at the appropriate time. So how do we then respond to something that's so overwhelming because we essentially repurposed our health service to be an infection control service? And how do we then call on those people who've been absolutely heroic to then now face a potential cancer epidemic, which is following a COVID pandemic? So they're really the challenges that I think, you know, that we have to take. And there are decisions that have to be made by governments as well as by individual hospitals or institutions.
Yeah, it's very concerning. And Shika, maybe you want to introduce yourself. Very keen to hear your story.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for inviting me for this really important panel today. In the U.S., we've had multiple studies showing that we're seeing a lot more late-stage cancers than we normally would, likely because people have delayed their screening colonoscopies, their screening mammograms, and also because people were avoiding coming into the doctor because they were scared to come in because of COVID. I had a patient who was very young, who was having rectal bleeding for months and didn't go into the hospital, didn't come in to see anyone because he was thinking, I would much rather just deal with these hemorrhoids and not worry about going in and potentially being exposed to COVID. And he ended up being diagnosed with metastatic cancer 8 months or 10 months later when he finally came in to see me. I don't think this is something we're going to know the true impact of until many years from now.
So what does need to change that we have a sustainable system also for the next, hopefully not waves to come, but we never know. Yeah.
I would say you wouldn't be able to find a single person who works in healthcare right now who did not say they were experiencing some symptoms of burnout. So we need to implement solutions to address the barriers and challenges that have led to this burnout. So we need to create systems for our healthcare workers where we have reliable childcare, where we have sick time that we can take off, where there are ways to support those people who are taking care of elder family members. From a patient side, I think that the disparities that we've all known have existed have really been put on the world stage, not just in this country, but when you talk about global vaccine equity, we haven't been able to get vaccines equitably across the world. We're seeing new variants pop up because we haven't been able to take care of the places that really need to be taken care of. So there needs to be a focus, not just on our healthcare systems, but on healthcare equity.
Yeah, so true. And Mark, I mean, where do you see the biggest areas for need of improved solutions going forward?
So one of the things we've highlighted, and it's really something that's very important, is we have the opportunity to reimagine cancer services so that they're different from what they were before. So what we said was, okay, let's look at developing a plan to build back better, but also to build back smarter. And the first thing is, we need to actually address the backlog in terms of screening, in terms of diagnosis, in terms of treatment, also in terms of research. And then we said, okay, we need to use data to our advantage. So we need to be able to have systems to collect data rapidly. And one of the things we've been pushing is, you know, we're now used to getting COVID statistics every single day. Why can't we get cancer data every single day? That would be really helpful for us in terms of making decisions, looking at innovations and looking at ways in which we can innovate quickly. Because I think one of the problems I think we've all found is the systems work too slow. And the other thing is working together. I think we've shown by vaccination that the only way to address things is by working together. And similarly, we should be doing exactly the same thing in relation to COVID and cancer.
Yeah. And Mary, maybe to conclude, you as someone who is going through active cancer care, you know, when you think about what needs to change, what you want to see from healthcare systems, from the support that you can receive.
I believe COVID identified what really is so very important. It is access to care. It is clear information. It is putting the patient at the center. And how can we build the system that's going to take the medical, the economic, and the mental and emotional side of cancer and build that back to support the patient and the doctors and nurses who serve us?
So I think we could have talked forever, but unfortunately we're running out of time. A big thank you to all of you for your so valuable insights and your suggestions. I liked what Mark said. It is an opportunity also to reimagine cancer care by taking the learnings to put the patient really at the center of that care and drive best outcomes for cancer. So big thank you to all of you for all these valuable insights.